Good evening, everybody. Welcome to our final workshop of our series that we did this fall. Tom Holcomb, the director of Rorschach College, and my associate here, Melissa Horman, the study skills coordinator for the College of Charleston for the Center for Student Learning. And we wanted to collaborate on a partnership here tonight to bring to you KeepCom and Acing the Finals exams, our test preparation for finals.
So, like we talked about before, who's ready for finals? So, you know, I think what we're trying to get across today is that you need to start studying today to be successful for finals. It's not that. You need to start preparing. What's that prep work that you need to do before a big exam, a really big exam that might cover 16 or more weeks of work or materials, that all that information that's given within that time. So what we're trying to get across today is just little steps that you can start taking now. So when it does come time for that final, you guys already know your schedule, you've looked on the back of that semester calendar, you're ready to take it. So with that, I wanted to start out with a quote. I love quotes since I gave them out for everybody. So can somebody read this out loud for me?
To be prepared for more than 1 month, let's be the most effective. One of the most effective means is preserving peace.
Great. So what does that have to do with final exams?
Best offense is a good defense.
Yeah, for sure. I think that's a great way to think about it. War, exams, you know. Anything else? I like that. So if you're confident and prepared, you won't freak out, you'll be at peace. So what I think about for war, or let's think about this as a race. You train all this time for a short amount of time, short amount of performance time. I mean, you can't just go out and run a marathon. Has anybody run a marathon before? It's miserable. Don't do it. Yeah, you don't. So you have to train for months before that, for just 4 or 5 hours of running. So it's the same thing for an exam. You can't just go in and say, I got this. You know, I can take this exam. I remember all the information. I looked over it 20 minutes before the exam. I'm ready. You really need to start training yourself. Think of this as a training program. You need to start now so then you'll be at peace then. You don't want to be freaking out at that point. That's not the time to freak out.
So one of the things we want to talk about tonight is that besides just preparing yourself, you know, with your notes and your study skills, it's a mental thing. So you have to mentally prepare yourself. And so here's some five positive things, or checklist for positive change. Okay, ask yourself, what do I want to do instead of work? So instead of worrying, what's one thing that you want to do? Maybe something you really enjoy, maybe something that makes you laugh, or something that really brings you peace or zen. Number two is get leverage on yourself and realize what worrying does to destroy your life. So realizing, today I had one of those worry moments, so it's a rare occasion, but it does happen. So just realizing that, you got to just take a deep breath and realize that you will get through it, okay? The positive change. Interrupt the pattern. You know, we all get in these habits, it becomes habitual. Stephen Covey says it takes 21 days to establish or to correct a behavior or habit. So, you know, start now with a few days left, so you still have some time to establish that. Create an empowering alternative, which is what we're hoping that tonight would be. Condition the new pattern and then test to see if it works. So, you know, don't just assume that it's going to work. You want to test it to see if it actually will work for you, because we're all a little bit different. We all learn a little bit different. We take information a little bit differently, so you got to test it to make sure it works for you specifically.
So, let's start out with just kind of making a pact here tonight to say we can make academics our top priority for the next week and a half. You guys see it right there in front of you on the semester calendar. It's only about a week and a half full left. 2 days, which are going to be freak out days for everybody before Thanksgiving, and then 1 day. So So can we all kind of agree that we can attend every class until the end of the semester? For Monday, Wednesday, Friday classes, it's 7 classes left? That's it? 7 meetings. Tuesday, Thursday, it's 4? That's not a lot. So, and canceling class at the end of the semester, you might have, you know, discussions or you don't have to go in. But can we all kind of nod and say, you know, we'll attend every class for the rest of the semester? This time is the most important time to go to class out of the entire semester. The whole semester is important, of course. But this time is really important because this is when they're going to give you study guides. This is when they're going to give you extra credit that they may not give you if you didn't attend class. This is when they're going to give you information that might be on the final. All of these things are really important. They're going to be discussing really important things in class. So make sure you're attending it. Using the resources around you, I think Tom can speak to this especially.
I think it's one of the things that, you know, sometimes students think that they don't have an option or they don't have an idea about how to change their way of studying when all along it's been sitting there right in front of them. So, you know, all you have to do is ask. So that's the hardest thing for most students to do is ask. But realize that there are resources here, not only for Chicago, but the Center for Student Learning. All you have to do is ask. And, you know, we do have walking appointments. I think you guys have, do you have walking appointments?
Yeah, you can stop.
Okay, it is a busy time of year for everybody, but just making sure that you actually take initiative, you actually go by and talk to somebody about an issue, especially if it's a study strategy or something that you're doing and you're like, well, this is kind of working, but I want to see if I can maximize my opportunity for learning and retention. So.
And everybody else is kind of going to be in the freakout mode when it comes to that. So start doing these things now, asking your professors questions now, asking us questions now, come into our offices. If my door's open, you can come in and sit down for as long as you want. Those are the things that you guys need to take initiative right now to start doing. There's a lot of resources on this campus, and they'll start shutting down sooner than later once finals begin. So take that initiative right now and start thinking, you know, what am I gonna need for the end of the semester? What am I gonna need for my finals? So find those resources on campus.
And then also, one more point is, you know, if you set goals for yourself, I think it's really cool if you set goals for yourself when you're studying. A lot of students don't think you can do that, but it actually works very well because it's kind of like a positive reward system. So when you actually sit down and actually work on your homework, kind of go over and make a little game plan, an action plan before you actually get started and see how much you want to accomplish for that day. That way, if you do small increments over time, you're actually going to have all the information you need.
So, let's talk about this question. What are our obligations before or during finals? Does anybody have anything that they need to do, that they have to do? Is anybody working?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Some, yeah, so maybe cutting back on hours if you can. Maybe work more hours before finals begin so then you have more time to study. Is anybody traveling for Thanksgiving break? That's going to be crazy. If you're traveling and trying to get back here, trying to study, trying to start the next week, all of these things you have to start thinking about. Does anybody have to move out at the end of the semester? Or moving at the end of the semester? Hopefully not, because that's crazy just to think about. So if you can try and avoid those packing sort of things, you know, where it takes a lot of energy, other energy away from you, that's good. Does anybody have any big projects that they have to do for the end of the semester, big papers or anything?
I have to write a small screenplay for my film class.
Yeah, that sounds pretty intense. So hopefully we've started those things or at least are thinking about them because it's going to happen sooner than later. Just to kind of look back at that semester calendar, I think that's the next one. So we are on the 14th. We only have one day left in this week. And then we have one full week. 2 days, Thanksgiving break, 1 day, reading day, and finals. So reading day is when we don't have any classes going on. It's a day for you guys to just kind of study. That's what we set it aside for you guys. So hopefully you're taking that day to sit down and study. The CSL closes on the 2nd. We do not do tutoring after the 2nd. We also do not do tutoring through Thanksgiving break. So if you're thinking about getting help, sooner than later. Again, right? We need to start thinking about these things now so we can plan for these days, the 25th and the 26th, and then I'm sure the 2nd on campus is just going to be crazy. A lot of professors disappear after classes are over. They're not even around on reading day. So if you have questions, if you start pulling together your notes and say, ooh, this part I didn't do so well on, I really think I should meet with my professor, that has to happen next week. You know, you need to start doing those things now. So what I would recommend this week, this is a good weekend just to kind of sit down with all of your material and start making folders. One folder for each class that can have all of your study materials from the entire semester in it. So whatever you use for first, second, third tests, any of your quizzes, anything that you kind of put together, put in that folder. Then start looking through it and saying, ooh, I threw away my note cards from test one. I have to remake them. You know, all of these things you need to know about now. So having those 4 or 5, however many classes, separate folders, you can take those folders to class and start, you know, pulling out things when they're like, ooh, this is going to be on the test. You know, remember this. Oh, yeah, I remember that from my study guide, from lesson 2, you know, all of these things. So that's when you can start pulling out different materials, and you're already set. You're set for that last week. You're set for when you need to start putting the final materials together and start studying for that. So that's what I would recommend this week, this weekend. Next week, talk to your professors. Go to their office hours. Say, this was my goal in the beginning of the semester. This was my goal grade. How do I get it? If I'm not there already, how do I get it? There's still time to ask for extra credit. Still time to do extra credit. There's still time to ask questions and do well on that last exam in that class if you do have it. There's still time. So don't think it's too late to meet your goals or to do what you wanted to do for this semester. You just kind of need to find that motivation, right? Like, it seems so far away. But what's your motivation right now to get those grades? What was that? There is a question.
It is a question.
Why don't you graduate? To graduate, I love that. It's such a good goal.
The end in sight.
Yes. Any other motivations?
Scholarships, grants. Always a plus for you, right?
So, the next kind of topic that we want to cover is managing your time. But you guys have already figured this out, right? You guys know how to put together a schedule. I gave out that 2-week schedule, the hour by hour. You guys probably know how to write that out and I'm going to study here, I figured this out, I know when I need to study, how I need to study, for the length of time I need to study. I think right now we need to talk about managing your behaviors. Because procrastination can creep in right now, you're tired, it's dark already outside. You know, all of these things are going to affect us in how we study. So, I think we should think about this in managing your behaviors. So make time for planning. You guys need to kind of sit down and say, all right, this is how much time I have left on my semester calendar. These are all the things that I have to do. Let me write that out on my weekly calendar. Here's 2 good weeks for you right there, front and back. Hour by hour, maybe, what you need to do, and just kind of lay it out there to make it realistic for you. It's ending. So make that real to you. Another thing is to push to avoid procrastination. This is really difficult for us. Those of us who are procrastinators, you can't break it, but like Tom said earlier, you can start managing those behaviors. It takes 21 days. You have a little bit less than that, but if you're conscious of something every day, you can kind of push through it. If you have that end goal in sight, graduation, or getting a scholarship, or not having to pay tuition next semester, think about that to just kind of finish out strong so that you can actually do it. It's realistic to you. Try not to cram. This is very important. So this is why we're here tonight, right? We want you guys to start early. Start early. Not cram at the end. That can really be inefficient for your time and your learning, which we'll talk about in a little bit. So, if you want to do the next one. So, I don't know if you guys have seen these triangles before. I show them a lot because I just like to say, here's kind of maybe actual or what we think about as the actual college student, and this is where we need to be. So what we're going to talk about here is kind of, let's think about this as learning. In actuality, maybe a lot of learning or newly learned information is done right before the exam in a lot of instances, because we don't do that much on a daily or weekly basis. So we're making those flashcards, we're learning, relearning, going over information a ton of times right before the exam. Right now we need to be here. So we have two solid weeks to kind of get you here. We need to be doing just a little bit more on that daily and weekly basis. So before the exam, should only be about 20% of your time should be towards studying. That's it, 20%. So before the exam, you can sit back and say, I can do this, you know. Don't cram any of those things, but maybe just a little bit more effort on that daily and weekly basis. Giving up, you know, that extra hour that you were going to watch Netflix tonight or something, right? I know it's hard for us procrastinators. But start orienting yourself with the materials, getting those things together. That's studying, you know, seeing that one more time. I always think of learning information like learning someone's name. I'm really bad at it. It takes me about 10 times before I can remember someone's name. Some of you, normal average person is about 7 times. That's newly learned information, right? A lot of the stuff that you're learning in your classes is newly learned information, just like someone's name. If you're in geology and you're learning all these new words, those are new names, right? So you have to associate it with something. You have to do something with it. But it needs to be done on a daily and weekly basis. You need to see that material 7 times, right, before you can actually remember it and put it down on a test.
One idea that I was talking with my staff organizational counselor today was kind of putting in things that maybe I'm not that interested in and, you know, getting kind of new motivation to them. Like, I'm an English major in a biology class. Mm-hmm. And it's like, okay, I could use it as research for another story that I could do now.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, find that motivation that works for your class. So in the next 3 slides, we'll go through this very quickly. So then you guys can just, I just want to show you guys, you have time to study. I promise you do. So you can't use that excuse of me, I just don't have the time. You can use the I don't have the motivation to study, but I just don't have the time. Here's tons of things that you can do in 5 minutes. Some of these things are studying. Some of these things are also social. So if you have 5 minutes, you choose. Do I want to study or do I want to do something social and take a break? So you can review notes, skip readings, update your schedule or your planner. If you wanted to kind of use that as planning time, right, we talked about that. Set up a group study session. So find that accountability partner that you guys have. Set something up with them to kind of meet up. It takes less than 5 minutes. Go through emails, make a quick phone call. Do a few sit-ups, you know. Just kind of get re-energized. The quick release sugar doesn't last very long. So you might need to do something that gets you back into it. But look at all the things that you can do in just 5 minutes. It's possible to get something done if you just kind of sit down and say, I'm going to do this, I'm going to get it done, 5 minutes, let's go. So in 15 minutes, even more. Look how much more you can get done. You can practice some flashcards if you have it on the go. Study blue on your phone. You can take it with you anywhere. Annotate on your notes taken in class. Some of that daily and weekly sort of work done in 15 minutes. Redesign text in increments. It's good to kind of break up your text. A lot of textbooks are written so you can actually, they're broken up for you in sort of areas. So why not just use it like that? If you get bored during your reading, or you start falling asleep during your reading, or you tend to look up and get distracted very easily, do it in increments. Take it in 15 minutes at a time, then the other 15 minutes, take a walk to relax, or take a 5-minute break and go get a cup of coffee. think about studying this way, so that you're not bored when you're studying with the topics. 30 minutes, even more can be done. Imagine what you can do in 30 minutes if I told you what you did could do in 5 minutes. You can study one topic in depth, so you can get all the way to that critical thinking level in 30 minutes, easily. It takes about 1 to 3 minutes to actually get to critical thinking, where you can start learning. You know how it's always so hard for that like first 1 or 2 minutes, you're like, all right, this is really difficult for me, I'm gonna push through. If you can push through that 1 to 2 minutes and get into the material, you can start learning. If you find yourself, you just can't push through, do something else, go run an errand or something. So there's lots of different things that you can do study-wise, as well as kind of a break within 5, 15, or 30 minutes. So here are some questions that you guys can just ask yourselves when you get stuck. I get stuck, we all get stuck. A lot of the times we get stuck when we're doing something maybe that we don't want to do or that we're getting bored doing. So these are some good things just to kind of check in with ourselves. What is one task I can accomplish? It's an easy way to break things down and say, well, you know, I can read for 15 minutes. I can read this section for 15 minutes. Am I being too hard on myself? Sometimes we're perfectionists and we just sit down to write that paper. We just can't get started for some reason. Or we're writing a thesis or we're writing a paragraph and we just can't finish it for some reason. So are you being too hard on yourself? Can you just write it? Is it just a draft? Just to turn in? Have I hit the study wall and need to take a brain break? So the study wall, right? This first 1 to 2 minutes. I also think of our attention span as your age times 2. So think about that. Anyone else? So, 50 minutes. So your attention span should be about 50 minutes for you. Age-wise, you know, whatever it is, that's kind of a good way to just kind of say, this is a good time to kind of check in with myself. Because maybe that's when your brain is just hitting that wall. You can't do anything else. Don't force it. If your brain's not there, don't force the learning because it's not going to learn. It doesn't want to do something. Just like you don't want to do something, you don't do it. Don't make your brain do something that it doesn't want to do. Can I do one more thing? It's a great way to think about, at the end of the day, it's one more thing that I can do. Even just updating your planner, something easy. What is the best use of my time right now? Is it this? Is it studying? Is it not? Should I not be studying right now? And did I just waste my time? Realistically, let's ask ourselves that. You know, did I just sit here and read a page reread it and reread it because I just wasn't paying attention? Maybe move on to something else that it doesn't take so much like in-depth, challenging sort of brain power. Move on to, I don't know, making flashcards or something fun where you don't have to sit there and get bored. Do something different. Shake it up a little bit. And then when you start procrastinating. So here are just some ideas that you guys can use if you start procrastinating. Make your plans public. You know that accountability partner or maybe a study buddy? Share your plans with them, why not? If you have a to-do list or a weekly calendar, if you want to scan this in, take a picture of it with your phone, text it to somebody, text it to me, and I'll email you. I'm fine with that. I'm sure Tom would too. You know, we'll stay on you.
Your mother.
If you want to know this. Is that
your mother?
Your mother? Oh my gosh, the worst. Don't email this to family because they will be on you. So find somebody, a mentor, somebody that you can trust to keep on you, to keep things going. Wunderlist, the app on your phone, you can actually put to-do lists in there and you can share it with people publicly. You can text it to them, email it to them, and they can kind of see live time as you're checking things off. So that's really cool too. Study with others. So when you're procrastinating, maybe it's not the best to study with others if they're procrastinating too. But if you can find those like people that sit in the front of the class, you know, find them and grab them and say, hey, let's study together. They'll keep you on task probably. Step back and check your progress from time to time. We just talked about this, right? Like, check in with yourself and say, did I just waste my time? Am I making progress in this? Should I continue studying this? Use the study power hour and save your procrastination habits as a reward. So those are the last two things for that. So let's talk about the cons of cramming. Because we all think we're wonderful at cramming, right? Like that last minute paper, I thrive on the adrenaline, trying to get it done right before it's due. And that's when I perform better. It's not true, actually. So all of your learning, you know, like I said, over time, right, we need those seven sort of touches for the material before we actually remember it. No new learning, you can't learn anything new within 12 hours of your exam. Nothing. As fast as it goes in, that's as fast as it'll go out of your brain. So, looking at your note cards before an exam is good, right? You just kind of want to check in with yourself. It also brings you confidence, but if you're trying to learn something, it's not going to work. So, know those limits. Cramming is not effective at all. So, don't stay up to study. Go to sleep. You need that sleep to actually learn. It's weird. You know how the critical thinking, you got to get into that critical thinking? Same with sleeping. Sleep on it. It's true. If you go to sleep and get into that REM cycle, I think it's called. Has anybody taken those kind of classes? So if you get into that REM cycle and go down deep into it, that's when your brain actually like stores information into long term. So you need to sleep. That's a great excuse to say, I'm just gonna go to sleep tonight. I'm just gonna sleep on it. That's how I learn. So cramming for several courses won't work. So if you are cramming for finals and you have two sort of exams in the same day and you're trying to just get that last minute information in, it's not going to work. Your brain's going to confuse it and it'll just fleet as fast as it went in again. So cramming is not learning. We all know that, right? We're not actually learning when we're cramming. So when you cram, it's temporary. It just kind of comes in and goes out. And cramming is actually more work. It makes your brain work harder than it's supposed to. So that's why you don't actually learn the material. And it also heightens anxiety and stress. We talked about being at peace earlier. Why would we want to do this to ourselves right before an exam? Anxiety and stress, have you ever seen those commercials? This is your brain on drugs, and they go around the kitchen smashing stuff. It's kind of like that. So this is your brain regularly, this is your brain on stress. So your neurons, all the things in your brain aren't firing together. They're not making room for new information. You're stressed out when you're studying, you're not actually gonna learn anything. So you need to be at a state of peace while you're studying, as well as when you're taking that test, because that's when your brain works the best. You need that time to just breathe and be okay with what's happening. So, leading us to active study strategies. So, has anybody taken the VARC before to learn your learning style or anything like that?
No. Cole, anything else?
No. If you haven't, we have some, I don't have them here, but we have VARC sheets in the CSL. They're also online, and there's tons of other things. I'm sure you guys are starting to figure out, though, these are the study strategies that work for me. I just want to open up a new world to you right now, because there's lots of study strategies that work for you, I bet. You're just kind of sticking to the traditional ones, you know? Flashcards work for me. I'm just going to stick to them for every single class. So there's different study strategies for each kind of class, especially if you're a kinesthetic learner. I'm a kinesthetic learner. I know I cannot sit still while I'm studying. I just can't. So I actually have to walk around while I'm reading to actually pay attention. It's the most bizarre thing, but I thought that I should sit at a desk with fluorescent light above me, and that's how I'll read, and this is how I'll learn. It's not true at all. You need to get up and move around if you're kinesthetic.
And another thing, too, I don't know if you know about this, but also I recommend if you're also a kinesthetic learner, if you go to the gym and take your book with you and get on the treadmill, you're actually working your muscles so you can actually study and read.
Yeah, so find out what type of learner you are. It's kind of fun. There's visual learners, auditory learners, read and write learners, and kinesthetic learners. I know a lot of us are kinesthetic, especially in our generation. So we like kind of hands-on stuff, you know, we want to feel things, we want to see things, we want to touch things. So that's kind of why we default to flashcards a lot. Chunky material to master it. So we talked about the 30, 15, 5-minute sort of things. Material is already chunked for you, pretty much. So if you can chunk it, revisit it, preview it, all of those things, you can actually master material. And I like to talk about the power hour because that's kind of where we talk about chunking the most. This can be kind of converted into any of your time limits, right? Your attention time limits. Mine's at 17 minutes. I know that. I have to stop at 17 minutes or I won't learn anything.
Does anybody know what the average attention span is?
Mm-hmm.
It's 20 minutes, yeah. The world record holder, he has a 45-minute attention span. So after 15 to 20 minutes, what happens? Well, we don't necessarily zone out. We're polyphasic thinkers. So what that means is that once after 20 minutes, our brain automatically starts thinking about other concepts. So you might be doing a biology lecture and thinking about, okay, here we're talking about the buses and all this good stuff, and then all of a sudden you're thinking about, okay, what am I having for lunch today? Am I going to have a wrap or am I going to have Chick-fil-A? And they're starting going down through those options, okay? And then about maybe 3 seconds later, you're talking about, what am I going to do with my friends tomorrow night, going out Friday night? You know, it's going to have all these multiple levels because that's the way our brain works. Our brain can only focus on a certain topic for 20 minutes at a time.
So, for the power hour then, let's call it the study half hour. Yeah, let's go at a half hour. So then we'll break this down. It won't be 5 minutes. It'll be maybe 2 minutes of a preview, right? You need to see the material before you actually dive into it. Has anybody read a book that they knew nothing about and they understood it and they retained it and they knew what was going to happen? Most of the time I like to read the summary or look at the, you know, the index or read the chapter titles just so that I have an idea.
I'm listening to Michael Goldberg's performance said, because the alien in not in the 90s remake of Out of the Service.
I've never heard of that.
It's kind of interesting.
Okay. Yeah. So that preview is important. We need to see that material once. There's our one touch. 20 minutes, study. Get into that critical thinking level. Get past that 1 to 2 minute sort of wall and get into the learning. Really learn. I mean, can we all kind of agree that 20 minutes studying, we can do that? 20 minutes is okay. It's not that difficult. So, sitting down, studying, 20 minutes, hard. Then 10-minute break. Let's say 5-minute break. 5-minute break. What were all those things that we could do? We could go get a cup of coffee and do some sit-ups. You know, there's tons of things that you can do in 5 minutes. Don't do something that's academic related. Look at your text. Look at Facebook if you want to. Any of those things. You know, that's the time to use that procrastination as a reward. Get on YouTube. You have, you know, 20 different videos lined up that are 5 minutes long that you can watch. Go on TED Talks. Whatever you kind of want to do. But do something that you enjoy. Because that'll kind of allow your brain to relax for a little bit, pump it back up, and then the last, let's say, 2 minutes, you're going to come back and review it. So we talked about the check-in. Let's check in with ourselves, see how it's going. Did I accomplish anything? What did I learn in these last 20 minutes? Did I learn anything? If not, maybe you should look at it again. So you're mastering the material before you move on to the next topic. You always want to make sure that you're checking in to say, did I learn this? Should I move on? Can I move on? Is this a good enough foundation to move on? Or do I need to do it again? So, look at all these different study methods. There's tons. I'm not going to go through them because I'm sure you guys know a lot of different ones. But there's a lot of verbs up here. Do, chart, predict, plan, direct, observe. Scout, know, redo, gather, outline, make, rewrite, put, plan. Lots of things that you can do to study. Don't just study traditional ways, because maybe that's not really the best way for you to learn. Try some different ways. And now you have time. You still have time to experiment, I promise, with some different things that might actually put you in with the material more than what you've been doing. You might actually retain more. You might actually learn more, putting it into that long-term memory. You might actually enjoy it more. Who would have guessed? Enjoying studying. So maybe you can actually enjoy what you're doing.
So one of the models of the Rohr Scholars Program is to don't study harder, but study smarter. Learn to fully maximize your full learning potential. And a few years ago, I learned about this method called mind mapping, and it was created by Tony Danzen. He is authored over 50 books, and he's also an Olympic coach. So he's trained people to be at work at optimum level and be your best 24/7. Okay? And what he says is there's true over here is the human brain. Most people think that when you read information, you're going to see words. Guess what? They found out we don't. We actually see pictures. We see pictures faster than words. So when you're actually studying, staring at a piece of paper, the first thing that jumps off the page is what?
Pictures.
Why? It's like a processing unit. It's like when you go to the computer and you look at a thing, what's the first thing that you notice? Pictures, the colors, right? The scheme, the background, usually, okay? It's not the tiny words that you see first, okay? So knowing that, you have to really train your brain to realize that pictures is the key, okay, to understanding a certain thing. It's like taking a big snapshot of what you're trying to accomplish. So he has this quote here. He said, anyone interested in learning in general, learning how to learn, should make mind mapping a part of the repertoire of skills, okay? And, you know, he is kind of a success guy. I have not got to meet him personally, but I've been using his method for a while. It does work. So this is kind of what mind mapping is. In the packet that we're going to give to you, we have a lot of information about mind mapping. And I kind of want to just cover a few things here because it's a lot of information. So basically what mind mapping is, it's like taking your brain and putting it in an organized fashion so that you have information at quick recall. Okay? So we store lots and lots of information. And most people, like Melissa was talking about in terms of studying, we cram. How many concepts, if you cram 4 days a week, if you're learning 5 new concepts a day, how much of that can you retain?
Probably only 1/4 of that.
Only 1/4. You know, a lot of statistical research has shown that at any given time, we can only hold from 16 to 20 new concepts at a time in our brain. And that's in our frontal lobe. Okay? So what we have to do is we have to train our brain to move information from our frontal lobe to our mid part of our brain, which is where lots of that information on long-term memory is stored, okay? And we actually have to actually make ourselves think that, to move. And you talk about memory, you talk about what you're passionate about, you talk about likes and dislikes. That's exactly how you do it. You do it by getting excited. Biology may not be the most important subject on your mind or exciting subject for you, but you have to find something about biology that makes you excited. So if using biology is that pivotal point to a future story that you're going to write or a narrative, that's what it's going to be. You know? It could be anything, right? All right. So here are the main reasons why you should mind map. So you know our brain is a huge cluster of information. So reasons why you should mind map is learning information, overviewing information, concentrating, memorization, organizing, presenting, and planning. It streamlines the process. So when you're learning new concepts, which way would you better have? A whole page or 3 or 4 pages full of information or an organized map that you can actually follow?
Organized map.
Right? Who doesn't like maps, right? When you go on a vacation or you go someplace new for the first time, what do you always have? At least? A what?
MapQuest
or TomTom or what's the other one?
Garmin.
Garmin, there you go, Garmin.
If you want to get through a game and you can't figure out how to do everything, look at the map.
Right, look at the map, look at the cheat sheet, right? Kind of shows you from point A to point B what you need to do, the best navigated route, right? Usually it gives you, or the Google navigation or whatever you use, gives you the best route to go from point A to point B, okay? So you avoid traps. So this is the reason why you should mind, and it does work, it's been proven. So. Here's how I actually have set up a mind map. So this is a mind map. I, in grad school, was having trouble learning 20 new concepts and theories in counseling. I had to learn a total of 36 new concepts in counseling to work with people. And I was like, dude, this is crazy. And our professor was not a lot of help. He was just like, here it is, study. Half the class was like, are you crazy? These are all things we have to know, we have to memorize, we have to interact with. This is insane. So I went back to what works. And I said, you know, I wonder if mind map would work on a graduate level, on professional understanding. I said, yeah, you know what, I'm gonna try this. So I started making mind maps. I made them on template in Microsoft Word. I created them, and I actually drew on big pieces of paper and stuff, and I studied them. Guess what? I got 95 on my final exam. So it does work. So number one, you start up here, and this is the center. So the center is the main thing. The main idea, subject or focus, is crystallized in a central thing. Okay? That's number one. Number two, the main thing radiates from the central image as branches. So you notice these giant branches. What did you notice about the branches? The what? They're all connected to the central thing.
They're all overlapping.
Colorful. They're all a different color. Why are they a different color?
So they can recall a different theme in your mind?
Exactly. So they're all sub-themes of a larger perspective, okay? So you want to make sure that they're different but similar because they're all attached to the main thing. Number three over here at the very part is the branches comprise a key image or key word drawn or printed on its associated line. So this one right here, so this line talks about relationships. And it says, for solution-focused counseling, the client equals the customer. So this little girl is putting money in a piggy bank. And for me, that kind of shows me, okay, the client is the person who is equal to the customer, okay? Number four down here, the topics of lesser importance are represented as twigs of the relevant branch. So you have these small little pieces, right? And what do those represent? Key points of your subject, of the larger thing, okay? Also, number five, at the very core up there, the branches form a connected nodule structure. So which way do you actually see the structure forming? Clockwise. Why is that? Well, no, well, why? Well, over this part of the world, we actually see things clockwise. We actually read left to right, okay? Left to right, so you go up. On the other part of the world, when you go out east, and you go over a lot of the Mediterranean countries and so forth, they read from right to left, okay? So they go the opposite way, which is very interesting to me. But it's how we actually perceive information and take it in. So it's very organized, it's clockwise, it's in a rotation, okay? Does that make sense? Yeah.
Mind mapping is great, and a great segue into this lovely triangle. Has anybody seen this triangle before? This is awesome. Good. Newly learned information tonight. So, what I want to get across to you with this is, let's use some other senses to learn, besides maybe just the traditional senses. We retain 10% of what we read. So if you're just going to read a book, and that's it, you're only going to retain 10% of it. That's kind of scary. So if you're reading notes, or rereading notes, or re-reading notes, you're only retaining 10% of it. You can retain 20% of what you hear. This is great, even better. You go to class, you sit in class, you can retain 20% of it probably. If you're an auditory learner, you can probably retain even more. But you can retain 20% of what you hear. That's sometimes why we can remember songs easier than probably books or words in books or quotes. Songs are very easy. 30% of what you see. So seeing as, you'll probably remember this triangle before you remember these words. So when we draw out a mind map, you can retain a lot of information just by doing that. So 50% of what you see and hear, even more, two senses, this is great. 50% of the information you can retain just by seeing this graph and hearing me talk about it. So you'll remember half of this, right? 70% of what you talk about with others. If you guys leave here and start talking about this graph, you'll retain 70% of it. That sounds even better. So study groups, oh my gosh, that's a great way to say, hey, do you want to talk about this? Can we just talk about this topic? You tend to sort of relate more to the material or can kind of talk through it. with someone else and retain it more. Just kind of verbalizing things helps a lot. Sometimes we talk in our head when we study, you know, like if you're in the library, that might be a good thing, but maybe find a place where you can talk out loud while you study. Verbalizing things helps a ton, because we're like, oh yeah, I did that. Oh yeah, I did that. And you don't tend to say it in your mind, but if you say it out loud, it sometimes helps. 80% of what you experience personally. So this isn't so much going to lab and, you know, working with the materials. It's more relating to the material. So if you can't, if you don't like biology and you can't remember the material for it, make a song out of it. Or, you know, relate it to something that, like your stories, write a story about it. You know, integrate it into your life. If you can experience it personally, you'll remember 80% of it. That's a great number. Great. But even better, 95% of the information that you teach other people. So I would say if you can teach Chem 111 to a third grader, you have mastered that topic. But that's a good way to think about it. You know, if you're like, oh, this History 116 is really hard, what if I just call a family member and I'll just talk them through it? If I can talk a family member through history and explain it to them so they understand, you have mastered the topic. It's not so much discussing it with other people, but you need to explain it to them so they actually understand it. That's why your professors are so knowledgeable about their topics, because they're talking about it, they're teaching you in different ways, they're giving their knowledge to you. So this is where we want to be. This is integrating all of our senses. You have to use all of your senses to teach other people. So as we go down this triangle, we see multi-sensory learning is really good. It can be good. So do different things. Shake it up a little bit.
And don't be afraid to try. That's the thing. Most students are like, I'm not trying this. I've got my study down. I know how to do it. But guess what? You've got time. So don't worry about what ifs. Worry about what actually could be.
So last but not least, we would love to talk to you about reducing stress and anxiety. Because remember that quote at the beginning? To preserve more is being at peace at the end. You know, we want to be at peace. This is the time of the year when a little freak out mode, you know, can happen. And that's not good, right? Our brains shrink. It's always that visual for me. I know my brain's here when I'm stressed out. I can't function. I can't think. I'm doing too many things at once, you know? You need to be reducing your stress during this time so you can actually function and do well on your day. So keep a healthy schedule. Eat lunch, right? We know our breakfast and lunch is important. Dinner is also important. Meals are important in general. So eating is important. Keep eating. Keep eating healthy things. All the sugar, I think this is great, actually, because it helps while you're studying. It keeps you kind of attentive. It makes your attention span a little bit longer, maybe. But you know you crash after that, right? So you have to eat more, and you have to eat more, and you have to eat more. Try and just keep a healthy sort of schedule. What I like to say for finals time is it's going to be no classes, right? Like you may have not any finals for 3 or 4 days, or you could sleep in all day and study whatever you want. That's great. But how about we kind of say, I'm going to keep the same habits, same schedule that I've had for the past 16 weeks, and get up at the same time that I normally would on each day. Study during those times that I would be in class, so use them as scheduled study times. You know, why say, well, you know, I can do it till later? Then our procrastination is kind of creeping in on us. So just kind of study when you were supposed to study. Your brain's already kind of in that academic mode, like, I've been going to class, I might as well keep going to class. You're already ready for it. So study during that time. Stay healthy during this time. Some studying is better than none. Try harder, you know, study smarter, not harder. So we want to start now doing those kind of things. Start studying in a way, you know, you're not sitting down and challenging your brain so much, but you're doing things, you're getting there, you're taking those necessary steps to be successful on that exam. And then start early to be prepared. We want you to have confidence going into this exam. So start now, right? Like, it sounds weird to start 4 weeks or 3 weeks before the exam, but start now, you know? It'll help you in the end.
Now, reducing stress and anxiety. You know, there's some certain strategies that I can kind of implement. And, you know, we talk about reducing stress. First of all, imagine or imagery. It's mental stress, okay? So it really helps in terms of visualizing what your even goal is. How many of you know about alpha state? You know what alpha state means? Any sport players in here? Okay. Well, alpha state is something I learned about a few years ago. And basically, the way it works is when athletes, before they actually engage in their sport, they close their eyes. So try this. So close your eyes. I want you to imagine a place where you are totally at peace with yourself, your surroundings. There's no anxiety, no fear. It's just total peace and bliss. Okay? Now, when you're in that place, you can put anything that you want in there. You can put a beach. You can put seagulls flying overhead. You can do a mountain with beautiful, pristine waterfalls. Or you could do a rainforest with a steam jungle. You know, whatever you want to put in that place, you can make that place become a visualized image of your peace. Okay? Now open your eyes. Now, when you guys were starting to visualize this place, what are some things that came to mind?
Beach.
Beach, okay. Anybody else? Same thing? Everybody really likes the beaches in Charleston,
beach.
Right? The beach, okay. So what else did you see besides just the beach? Did you see a sunset or a sunrise? Did you feel the breeze? Or did you see birds, seagulls, okay? What about dolphins? Did you see any dolphins? No, no dolphins. What kind of sounds did you hear? The ocean. Was it crashing waves? Was it calm waves? Okay. What was the atmosphere like? Was it cold? Was it just right? Was the sand warm beneath your toes? Yeah. Once again, these are sensory things. That's why I'm asking, okay? But using that skill really can help you, benefit you in terms of dealing with stress and anxiety, okay? Of course, number two is meditation. This is with relaxing and sustained concentration. So you don't have to be the world's greatest yogi or Zen master to meditate. All it takes is a will and an ability to sit there and kind of focus on what your overall goal is, okay? Using music or relaxation tapes, of course, that definitely helps. Who doesn't like listening to the ocean sounds? Or my favorite is thunderstorms. I love listening to thunderstorms. It's so relaxing to hear, especially when drizzling down. Oh my gosh, I can sleep all day, all night with thunderstorms. But just imagine what that music can do for you in terms of helping you cope with mental stress. And that helps with easing mental relaxation. Physical techniques, deep breathing, okay? So one thing I always say, if you're really stressed out and you're taking this test, you're like, oh my gosh, when you first get in there, what I want you to do is clench your fist, okay? Clench your fist right now. Clench your fist, okay? I want you to focus all of your negative response, all your anxiety, all your fears and stuff into your fist, okay? Just hold that there for a few minutes, okay? We're going to do something with that in just a second. So deep breathing is something that works really well with you because you allow yourself to inhale and exhale. So you're like, you're breathing in good oxygen or breathing in good positive energy and you're exhaling negative energy, okay? Now, what are you feeling in your fist right now? You feeling tension? You feeling that tense, your body tensing up, okay? Now I want you to slowly open, on the count of three, open your palms. So one, be thinking about opening your palms. Two, starting to open, and you should have to really open them up by three, okay? Now, what I did right there, it was a physical response. If you visualize your stress and anxiety in the palms, and you hold it there right before you take a test, and then you take three deep breaths, inhale and exhale, and visualize that stress, letting go of that, guess what? You start out your test with what? No stress. See, it's really easy, fast. All right. Also, progressive muscle relaxation and relaxation response, it kind of goes into more specifically. We have a lovely how-to picture and poster, I guess, in the Noble office now, thanks to Ian, about yoga poses and stuff, which definitely will come into play if you guys need to release some stress and anxiety. And then putting all the stuff together, so using music, using visualization, using deep breathing, using muscle relaxation and response, putting it all together to help you really release all that tension and stress before you actually take your test or before you're studying for your test. That way you're not stressed out.
I learned something interesting about anxiety the other day. I thought, you know, anxiety was just, some people had it and some people didn't. And, you know, you were born with it. Anxiety is a learned behavior. We do this to ourselves. It's crazy. So if you have anxiety about studying or about taking a test, there's something that happens. It's about, I think, a millisecond between hearing about a test and hearing about something that could possibly cause anxiety and the actual event that happens. Something is in there. We have some self-talk, and it's probably negative. That's what's causing that anxiety. So, all of these things can help that self-talk be positive. And anxiety is gone. Honestly, that's it. That's all there is to anxiety. So, if you can help yourself these next few weeks just to kind of practice these things and start, you know, that positive self-talk, sounds kind of weird, like, pump yourself up, but it works. That's all there is, and you can have anxiety gone like that. If you have blank outs on tests, those are the worst. So there's something that happens, right? You go from, I have this, I've studied for this, I'm prepared, all the way to, I don't remember a thing. There's something that happens. So these things can help that become positive. So it's completely changed around. You're ready to go. You have no negative talk in your life. It's just, I got the confidence to do that.
So Anthony Robbins says there's really what you have to do in terms of thinking positive is you have to really, change will do you good. Okay? So I know a lot of us don't like change. I mean, I myself particularly don't like it at all. Unless it's change that I initiate, but if it's something that happens just vicariously in front of me, it takes a little bit of time maybe to adjust and to rearrange things. So, first of all, you have to change your limiting beliefs, okay? So your limiting beliefs are things that exactly what Melissa said. They are learned behavior. So first of all, you've got to believe yourself. That's the number one thing. Most students, when they're in a class that they're having trouble with, they're like, I can't do this. Well, why can't you? Is it because the material is a little bit harder than you're used to? Is it because this class itself is helped weighted in terms of where you're going with your progression of your major or your future? You think about those things. So you got to believe in yourself. Beliefs tell us how things are, what's possible and what's impossible, what we can do, what we can't do. Okay? So if something seems impossible, guess what? We have to change that limiting belief. They shape our every action, every thought, every feeling we experience that are in our whole daily structure, our whole lives, our weekly and monthly, and semester. You gotta change your strategy. Something's not working, guess what? Gotta change it. So you see a lot of class people know what to do, but few people actually do what they know. Okay? So there are a lot of people out there that know, well, I should probably do this, or I should probably do that, but guess what? It's called a coulda, woulda, shoulda, is what I call it. You know, I could have asked for help. I should have asked for help, but you know, my pride got in the way, or I can't ask for help because I'm seen for whatever reason. You know, and most students, you know, think that, and that's not the way it really should be or the way it is. You know, my grandmother used to tell me, the hardest lessons in life are the ones that we don't learn. Think about that. The hardest lessons in life are the ones that we don't learn. And then finally, master. You have to master the mastery over emotion, physical, relationship, financial, and time. You know, it's pretty easy to say that for somebody to master your emotions, but eventually in time, you've learned how to do that. You learn to cope, you learn to manage so that the emotion doesn't actually take you over, but you actually control your emotion.
I just heard something really cool today that positive attitude or your attitude in general is directly correlated with your grade on a test. With a positive attitude, I think they said you can improve your grade 10 to 12 points just by attitude alone. right? So this positive talking, right? Like, why not do that? Why would it be positive? I could get 105 then, you know? Or it could be the difference between a C and a B and an A. Something substantial. I mean, all it is put in your headphones, listen to that pump up music on your way into that test, and saying, I can do this. All it is. It's crazy to think that. Like, crazy to think that. But how amazing would that be if you can change your grade just by saying, I can actually do this? Yeah. So, last but not least, we want to give you the schedule for Cougar Countdown. It should be online soon, if not now. But has anybody been to Cougar Countdown before?
Yeah, it's awesome.
It's amazing. If you have not, please come. There is free stuff from Tuesday, which is reading day, all the way until the last day of finals. We do coffee every morning for y'all. We do free Zumba and yoga. And oh my gosh, Friday is my favorite day. If you guys can make it to all the events on Friday, I would recommend that highly. President Benson will be out there flipping pancakes for you, serving you, which is amazing. You can talk to him if you'd like. He's great. And then from 12 to 3, it's Pets for Less Stress. We bring puppies from all around the Charleston area in the different shelters, and you can just play with them. It's amazing. So why not go to that?
And I believe, if I remember correctly, I think Laura is sponsoring the coffee break on Thursday.
Yeah, I think so.
So yeah, you definitely come out.
We have Battle of Bakeries this year, which is really cool. It's going to be a lot of fun. So we're having bakeries from all around Charleston donate food, so there will be a lot of food there, I have a feeling. So the 5 minutes, the 10 minutes, the 15 minutes that we talked about, you could do this, right? Like, go get a cup of coffee, go to yoga. If you've never done it before, I did yoga once and I hated it, so I'll never go back. But yoga might be for you, you know, like just getting in there. Go to Zumba. I love Zumba. I'm a Zumba person, not a yoga person. So Zumba is where it's at if you need a break. Like, take these breaks. It's all free. Do it, you know? Like, we have great offices around campus sponsoring all these events. So if you have time, come out. Come do these things. We're trying to, you know, get that healthy schedule, get the check-in time for you, relaxation time, so then you can go back and hit the books hard. So. Those are probably in Rivers Green.
Rivers Green, I think.
Yeah, I think they're in Rivers Green. I took off all the things because there's a lot of information on here. So I think most of the calendars should be up on the website already.
And we actually get it and we'll send it out to you.
Perfect.
So you guys will get it. So. And if you came to this workshop, we'll send it out to you too.
Perfect.
So.
We will make sure you get it.
You will have it.
So that's all we have for you guys. I have some extra worksheets up here for you that are interested. Motivation, you know, what's your motivation, all of those things. So
there's information that they provided with preparing for tests, as well as some things about empowerment from the War Scholars Program, as well as some additional things. And for me, Melissa introduced a way that is similar to the way that I interview, that I work with students, but I look at it this way. Any pre-med majors here? Pre-pharmacy, all right. Think about the human body. The human body itself is made of what?
Water.
Okay, that's obvious. Water, blood. Well, let's think about it. So water and blood, and what else is water? We got cells, we got organs, right? And what are systems, thank you. And the systems do what?
They all work together.
They have a cycle, right? So a digestive system, right? Our respiratory system, our circulatory system, our sleep cycle. If you're a woman, there is that time of the month.
Menstrual
cycle, yes. So all our bodies are on systems. So it's natural to think about, in terms of studying, to think about what we call internal biorhythm, because our body actually has an internal biorhythm, right? When you go get your EKG at the hospital, they hook you up to all these electrodes, and they're testing to see what your internal biorhythm. Listen to your heart, listen to your lungs, listen to your stomach, all kinds of things to make sure there's no weird sounds and stuff. Okay, so by knowing that is this whole method of rhythmatic study. So you're gonna start out really kind of slow, first of all. You're gonna do, as Melissa said, do a little preview, which I kind of like that aspect, so I might take that.
do a little preview, but then you're going to study for 15 to 20 minutes. But I want you to start with the hardest subject first. Don't start with the easiest subject. And there's a reason for that. Because you're going to save the easiest subject for last as a reward. It's a positive reward. Because usually, if that's your favorite subject, what is one thing that you're actually going to know pretty well? Right, you're going to know most of the subject area. You're probably going to know the majority of the material, and you're really going to enjoy it, right? So you're going to finish strong, right? And we talked about finishing strong. So you're going to start off with the hardest subject first, because you might have to go through maybe 4 or 5, 15 to 20 minute increments and a 5-10 minute break before you actually get to where you feel like you've actually retained the information, okay? Now, one thing, when I always talk about learning, don't study harder, learning smarter, most people never realize that the brain, guess what? It's boring. And what does it like to do? It likes to be challenged. It likes to be challenged. But it likes to rest too. That's pretty good. So what you have to do is we actually, in that challenge, basically by doing 15 to 20 minute increments and take a 5-10 minute break, you're going to maximize your learning potential. Okay? You're going to actually make your brain work more effectively for you in those 15 to 20 minute increments than if you would actually work, say, 2 or 3 hours long and take a break. Okay, because really, how much of that information in 3 hours are you actually going to retain? 15 minutes, 20 minutes. So you wasted pretty much 2.5 hours right there. And 30 minutes of that has just been actually learned material. The rest of that time has just been wasted. Okay, so don't study harder, study smarter. Learn to maximize your full learning potential. If you want additional help with that, I'm sure Melissa and myself will be available to help you. Lots of resources up here, and I think I'm going to end with your little jingle.
Oh, you guys got your fortune cookies, right?
Yeah.
Good.